Thank you. It's a great pleasure to be here to discuss about open hardware. I would like to thank the organizers for the opportunity. And all of you for choosing to spend some time with us, listening, and then hopefully in a lively discussion. So my goal today is not to give you an inventory of everything that's happening in the open source hardware world. That would be too hard. I will talk rather about the concepts, and I will illustrate them with examples. And because I come from CERN, many of these examples will be from CERN. So I will start with a quick introduction to CERN, so that you can place these examples in a context. Then I'll move on to open source hardware. What it is and why it is so important. After that, I'll look at the perceived benefits, perceived issues, and the recipes for success. After that, I would like to speak about public institutions and why I think they are special because they are in a different economic actor. I will also say some words about the future, both about what I think it holds, but also how we can shape it to make hardware sharing easier. And then I'll finish with a conclusion and place for discussion. So, CERN's main mission is to conduct fundamental research in the field of physics. To discover what the fundamental components of matter are. And also their basic interactions. A lesser known mission, but also very important, is to communicate the results of this research and also all the developments that we carried out on the way to discoveries. Now, CERN can be seen as a production line and the end product of that production line is beams of particles. These beams are made to collide and the physicists study what comes out of those collisions. So here's a depiction of the network of accelerators at CERN. The biggest one in green is the Large Hadron Collider. It's 27 kilometers long.
meters
underground.
100 meters abaixo da Terra.
And it's the biggest particle accelerator in the world, straddling the border between France and Switzerland. If we look at what's inside the tunnel, we see some radio frequency cavities and some radio frequency cavities and a long sequence of electromagnets.
Mm-hmm.
The purpose of those components is to accelerate the particles. And also constrain them to stay in the circumference because they have a tendency to go straight. The conditions inside this tube are quite extreme. The whole thing is at 2 Kelvin, so 2 degrees above absolute zero. So making it the biggest cryogenic installation in the world. The pressure inside the tube where the particles are is really low. It's emptier than outer space. So you see there's a number of technological challenges. And then in 4 points around the LHC, particles are made to collide. And around those points, there are particle detectors, which are the size of cathedrals, and they are 100 meters underground. They spit out big amounts of data. Totaling around 15 petabytes per year. And then the physicists examine these data to find new physics. Now, moving on to open source hardware. In 2006, I was asked to start coordinating a section at CERN. Called the timing and hardware section. It's made of two teams. The hardware development team and the software development team. And very quickly, I realized that their daily work experience was radically different in terms of how easy it was for each team to interact with the outside world, learn from others, bringing new talent, collaborate with commercial companies without giving up control of their project. So the software team was in the Linux kernel community, and they were practicing free software, and the hardware team was in a mostly proprietary world. And therefore, they were not enjoying all these good things of free software. So we set out ourselves the mission. Can we make it such that the software team enjoys a similar environment? Now, why is this important? It is very important because designing hardware has become so much easier in the last years. And things which are easy to do and useful have a special relationship with freedom. For example, if a world power decided to forbid travel to Jupiter, not many people would complain, because people don't know how to do it anyway. On the other hand, if they forbid us to cross the street or to cross the border between Brazil and Argentina, there would understandably be strong protests, because it's useful and it's easy to do. Therefore, it is important to safeguard that freedom. So, let's see some examples of how hardware design has become more accessible and easier. This is a GPS watch. It's a, more than that, it's a delirium in scope creep. It has a pressure sensor. It has a compass, ambient light sensor, temperature sensor, and this, a few years ago, would have needed the talents of a small company. But instead, it was done by a bunch of friends, staying after work on Friday evenings to offer it as a gift to a colleague who was retiring. And he was a leader of the timing at CERN, and he was a good hiker. So it seemed like an adequate present. What's more, in this project, we limited ourselves to using just free software tools. The PCB inside is done in KiCad. PCB inside is done with KiCad. The case is made with FreeCAD and sent to a 3D printing shop. Another example, this guy was born with a malformation in his hand. And he's wearing a prosthetic hand, which has been 3D printed. The hand was designed by his mom, who never received formal training in mechanical engineering. This started with a guy called Ivan Owen, who's a special effects designer. He put something on the web, and then somebody contacted him asking if he could do hands. One thing led to another, and next thing you know, there's a community of 3,000 people collaborating on design and 3D printing of hands. Most of them without formal training in engineering. Another example, this time about water distribution. So, as you know, access to clean water is a big concern. Millions die each year because of bad water. And hundreds of millions have very difficult access to clean water. There are something like 500,000 wells in Africa. NGOs go and drill the wells, and then they go back home, and some of them start failing in such a way that at any time there are something like 30% non-functioning wells.
De poços que não funcionam.
So Tim Burke and some friends in California set out to design an open hardware monitoring solution. And trained local people to be able to debug it if there was any problem. So we all know that open source hardware helps with vendor lock-in. But when your water distribution system depends on somebody who's thousands of kilometers away, the problem of locking takes a different dimension. And to finish, I would like to show you this very cool project. In 2011, as you know, there was a big accident in Fukushima. In the days that followed, the stocks for Geiger counters were depleted. And there was a need for reliable radiation data. The government was releasing not much data. And people did not know if they could trust this data. So some people teamed up to design a piece of open hardware. Which includes a Geiger counter and a GPS receiver. So people stick this box called Safecast on the cars. And they start driving around and logging data and position, so radiation data and position. And when they go back home, they connect the box to the computer. And they upload the data to a server so it's available for everybody to see. After a few years, they gathered the biggest radiation measurement database in the world. What's more, this data is very trustworthy. Because people are driving around and they don't know each other. So the data is very difficult to fake. If you try to fake it, it will look like an outlier. And of course, being open source hardware and open source software, is part of the trustworthiness of the project. Now, since it's become very important, since it's become very easy to design and share hardware, it's important to formalize and protect this freedom. That's why a definition was prepared. And it's now hosted by the Open Source Hardware Association. They took as an inspiration the definition of open source and the four freedoms of free software.
Do software livre e nesses quatro pilares da liberdade.
And the definition guarantees these freedoms to study, modify, distribute, and make.
Então, isso que garante essa liberdade, esses pilares são estudar, modificar, distribuir e fazer.
Now, one difference between free software and open source hardware.
Agora, uma diferença entre o software e o hardware livres e abertos, entre os dois,
is that choosing whether companies are involved or not is not an option in open source hardware.
É que escolher se as empresas estão envolvidas ou não, não é uma opção no hardware aberto livre.
Somebody must make this hardware.
Alguém precisa criar, fazer esse hardware.
Test it and sell it.
Testar, e daí vender. Mm-hmm.
And there is one thing to which companies are allergic, it's legal risk.
Se tem uma coisa que as empresas têm alergia, são os riscos legais.
So it's good to have a license text that makes it clear what the conditions for using the material are.
Então, as condições para usar, né, e modificar esse material essencial são.
So at CERN we teamed up with the Knowledge Transfer Group. And we drafted a license which is better adapted to hardware than licenses which were not made with hardware in mind. Clarity was a key goal. So that licensors can evaluate if it's good for them. It's inspired, as many, thing in, many things in open source hardware, it's inspired by free software. It's specifies the freedoms that the licensee has.
Especifica a liberdade, as liberdades que esse hardware livre tem.
To study, modify, manufacture, and share.
Estudar, modificar, compartilhar.
And it is persistent in the sense that if somebody modifies the design.
E é persistente no sentido de que se alguém modifica o design.
And releases and releases the modifications. Publishes. This distribution must be made under the same license. And then it takes into account that ultimately these files will be used to produce hardware. There is a gentle invitation for the producer to inform the licensor of production. Anything beyond an invitation would not be free. And then there is a serious try to ensure that whoever receives the pieces of hardware has access to the design files. There is a serious try to ensure to ensure that whoever this, receives these pieces of hardware, has access to the design files. Of course, this is something that depends on the particular piece of hardware, and it's something which is something we can discuss about later. CERN Open Hardware License is one among a set of possible licenses for open hardware. So you can also check out the Tapper Open Hardware License. Prepared, drafted by John Ackerman, very competent lawyer. And the first person who thought about drafting a persistent license for open hardware.
fazer esse aspecto da persistência.
And then in terms of permissive licenses, those which are not persistent.
E depois em termos de licenças permissivas, essas que não são persistentes.
You have the solder pad license.
Você tem um solder pad. A licença solder pad.
Okay, moving on to benefits.
E agora passando para os benefícios.
Of course, as in the case of free software.
É claro que como é no caso da software livre.
Reuse is a key benefit.
A reutilização é um benefício chave, principal.
If you don't spend your time reinventing the wheel.
Se a gente não investe tempo reinventando a roda.
You can use that time to improve things and innovate.
Você pode usar o tempo que você faria isso para renovar, para reutilizar.
Here's an example of a board.
Então aqui tem um exemplo de um
placa.
De uma placa.
Which is hosted, the design files are hosted in the Open Hardware Repository.
Que esses arquivos estão contidos no repositório, fazem parte do repositório.
Which is a place on the web with the usual suspects.
Que é um lugar na rede com os
usual suspects.
Tools.
Com as ferramentas usuais.
Wikis, repositories.
Os wikis, os repositórios.
A mailing list manager. Now, in terms of reuse, here's an example. At CERN, we need to control accelerators. And we need the pieces of controls and data acquisition hardware. Be synchronized, even if they are very distant with respect to one another.
Se eles estejam sincronizados, por mais que estejam muito distantes uns dos outros.
So we designed a synchronization system.
Então projetamos um sistema de sincronização.
Which is an extension of Ethernet.
Que é uma extensão da Ethernet.
Which ensures that time is synchronized all around the accelerator.
Que assegura que o tempo seja sincronizado todo em volta do acelerador.
To within 1/1 of a second.
Dentro de 1/1 de segundo.
And this is open source hardware.
E esse é open source hardware aberto e livre.
And it has been reused in many other scientific installations.
E foi reutilizado em muitas outras instalações científicas.
Which was something to be expected.
Era algo esperado.
But when you open source, there's also the unexpected.
Mas como o hardware open source, aberto e livre, também tem o inesperado.
People can take your hardware and have crazy ideas for using it.
Podem pegar o seu hardware e ter ideias malucas para usar, para como usar.
For example, in the European Union,
por exemplo, na União Europeia,
when the EU is trying to solve a problem,
quando a União está tentando resolver um problema,
experts are invited to send them proposed solutions.
Os especialistas são convidados a enviar soluções, proposições.
And a guy in Finland, who we didn't know,
e um cara na Finlândia, e isso a gente não sabia,
proposed the use of this White Rabbit synchronization system.
Propôs o uso desse sistema de sincronização
for locating victims in accidents.
Para localização de vítimas de acidentes.
By timestamping the heartbeat of their mobile phones.
Sincronizar o timestamping. O ritmo dos seus celulares do
in mobile base stations
em bases celulares de telefones celulares
which are very well synchronized with one with respect to one another
que são daí muito bem sincronizados um em relação ao outro
and triangulating
triangulando
to find the location of the phone
para daí encontrar a localização do telefone.
Then there is the example of power grids.
E daí temos exemplos dos power grids.
As you know, in the future, we're all going to become producers and consumers of electricity.
Como você sabe, no futuro, vamos ser todos consumidores e produtores de eletricidade.
And there, we need an orchestra director to handle the flow of that power.
Então, precisamos de um condutor para controlar o fluxo dessa capacidade.
So there are people, to my surprise, the synchronization requirements are under a microsecond.
Então, para mim, o meu espanto, que é requerido.
Under a microsecond, we need to be more precise than a microsecond in terms of synchronization. So there are people in a university in Lausanne working on using White Rabbit to synchronize these stations. Now, another clear advantage of open source hardware is the avoidance of vendor lock-in. Now, people sometimes talk about open versus commercial. But in fact, it's a bit more complex. It's a two-dimensional problem. The opposite of open is proprietary. And the opposite of commercial is non-commercial. So you have four possible combinations. In a project which is open and non-commercial, the problem is it can die of success. Because developers must give a lot of support. So they have less time for development. Projects which are commercial and proprietary suffer from vendor lock-in. But open and commercial gives you the best of both worlds. Because you get commercial support without the risk of vendor lock-in. This is the example of the board I showed a couple of slides ago. The design files are available for everybody. To manufacture and sell products based on them. And today you can buy this board from three companies, one in Spain, one in the Netherlands, one in Poland. In Poland. Now, if you are in the business of dissemination, of making your results available,
agora, se você tá para disseminar, para fazer com que tudo isso seja disponibilizado,
open source hardware is a very efficient way of doing it.
O hardware aberto e livre é uma maneira muito eficiente de fazer isso.
People come to need or to want to do dissemination for very different reasons.
As pessoas chegam com a necessidade de disseminação
And in the case of many public institutions, and in the particular case of CERN, it's in our mandate. So here you have the sentence of the CERN convention that makes that clear. And these people drafted the convention in the 50s. You see, people met without laptops and still got work done. And the issue now is how to interpret that mandate in the technological scene of the 21st century. So, in the case of CERN, there are many people, thousands of people. Some of them develop software. And for them, developing open source software, free software, is a very natural way to fulfill this mandate.
E para eles, desenvolver esse software livre e aberto é uma maneira muito natural de cumprir com esse mandato.
Some people are in the business of keeping experimental data.
Algumas pessoas estão ali para reter, né, para cuidar de dados experimentais.
And they have built infrastructure to make sure that that data is publicly available.
E construir uma infraestrutura para assegurar que esses dados sejam de disponibilidade pública.
It's called open data.
Se chama open data, os dados abertos.
And it aims at making it possible for people to reproduce the experimental results.
E almeja fazer com que as pessoas possam reproduzir esses resultados experimentais.
There are also people who deal with scientific publications. And they do something called open access with many other institutes. Open access takes a market, which is that of scientific publications.
É o mercado das publicações científicas
and turns it somehow upside down.
E vira do avesso.
In a traditional scientific publication market, readers buy subscriptions to journals.
Os leitores, eles compram, né, recebem uma assinatura.
This money pays the editors who correct the articles. And provide infrastructure for the publication. But that establishes a monetary barrier for some readers. In open access, the cost of the editing.
No acesso aberto, o custo da editar,
is borne by the scientific institutions which host the scientists.
É comprado pelas instituições científicas que fomentam os cientistas.
And the access to the readers is free and unencumbered by any obstacle.
E o acesso do leitor é livre e sem impedimentos.
So, for the case of hardware, it looks very natural that hardware designers at CERN.
Então, no caso do hardware, ficou daí extremamente natural para quem, para os criadores de hardware no CERN.
To design using open hardware.
Yeah, esse hardware fosse livre.
Moving on with the list of perceived benefits.
Prosseguindo com essa lista de benefícios percebidos.
Motivation and recognition is very important.
A motivação e o reconhecimento são muito importantes.
Designers typically prefer to collaborate.
Os designers que projetam preferem colaborar.
Than to work in isolation.
Mais do que trabalhar de maneira isolada.
Open hardware is also good for hiring and retaining talent.
O hardware aberto livre também é bom para contratar talento e para manter o talento.
Again, as has been seen with free software. And finally, recognition and prestige is very important for companies. So, for example, if somebody asks a question in a forum, many companies see that as an opportunity. To gain prestige, which they can then easily monetize. For small and medium-sized companies, there are also clear advantages. The barriers to enter a market. Because in a proprietary setting, it's very difficult for them to capitalize on a pile of previous work. And in open source hardware, Again, as in the case of free software, we can do that. Also, these companies often are small and they don't have all the talents required for designing a piece of hardware. So it's easier for them to get help, including help from the client, which happens actually quite often. Now, from the perspective of an advocate of open source hardware, it's always useful to ask skeptics what issues they perceived in open source hardware. Now, one of the most recurrent arguments, it's actually an attack on the concept itself. They say, okay, so you want this PCB to be open? But what about the chips in the PCB? Do you care so much about their openness because they're not open? So here again, the easiness argument applies. It's not so easy today to design chips. So it is becoming more accessible. There is, for example, the example of the low-risk project, which is an international collaboration. Coordinated from the University of Cambridge. They are designing a system on chip. Which they will then manufacture in volume. So there will be more competition for Intel, ARM, and others. Then there is the issue of commodity hardware. Some chips have been compatible replacements. There are also PCBs with standardized input-output, like the motherboard of a personal computer. It has PCI Express, USB, Ethernet, and it's relatively easy to exchange one by another. So the risk of vendor lock-in is less serious. And the case for open sourcing is therefore a bit weaker. Another issue that people often mention is, if I want to design or have some hardware designed for me, and if I specify that it shall be open source hardware, will I find commercial partners to work in that way? Well, there is nothing specific to open source hardware here. If you have money to buy something, there's a lot of competition out there. And the chances of you not finding somebody who will do it for that money are close to zero. It's just plain old supply and demand. Then there are a number of issues I classify as expectation management. People ask, can I really control all the manufacturing and distribution of an open source hardware design I release? Here I should make an aside to explain a bit about licensing. In a license, you grant a right to somebody that he or she otherwise wouldn't have. In exchange of granting that right, you require that this person promises you something. And this is, for example, how the GPL license works. Copyright law says that you, in principle, don't have the right to copy and distribute copies. You can't copy and distribute those copies of documents. So GPL grants the GPL license, by the GPL license, the author grants that right. In exchange of the promise that these modified copies will be distributed using the same license, therefore perpetuating this virtuous circle of sharing. However, there is no law that says that it's forbidden to manufacture goods based on a design. At least not in the general case. So our ability to control the manufacturing and distribution of hardware is necessarily reduced. Another issue I call comparing apples to apples. Is also frequently encountered in the free software world. People ask, okay, this piece of software is nice, but it's not as nice as this other proprietary piece of software I'm using. And they don't take into account the fact that they may have spent a lot of money on licensing fees for that proprietary piece of software. So they should be asking themselves how the free software option would look if they had invested the same amount of money. And whether it's still time to change and start investing in that free software option. And sometimes they themselves have invested a lot of their own work building upon that proprietary piece of software. Enriching its ecosystem and making the lock-in case worse. So sometimes it just might be too late. Finally, in the expectations management, again, as in free software, there is the promises not upheld problem. Somebody publishes a design on the web. And all these things that open source hardware promises, like bug fixes and people suggesting modifications, do not happen. And the question there is, did your design cover somebody else's needs? Was it of interest to anybody else? Was it easy to understand and to modify? Was it easy to report bugs? To report bugs, to inform. Again, things that have nothing to do with open source hardware. Now, of course, a concern very often expressed by companies is, will people steal my design and make money off it? And the answer is, if it's a very cool piece of hardware, yes, they will steal the design. And they will do that irrespective of whether it's open source hardware or not. So building a business model on top of this assumption that your design will not be copied is a very risky prospect. And unless your design is really high-tech and you have a large legal department. But then, how does Arduino survive? I have my own theory based on why I pay money to Arduino. When I download Debian, I can very easily obviate the donate button. When I download Debian, I can very easily obviate the donate button. Yeah, I can ignore it. I can ignore the donate. Yes. In hardware, I don't have the option, I have to pay. So there is this big inertia move, which is pulling out the wallet. And I have to overcome that inertia. I don't have any choice. Once the wallet is out, doing the right thing is not so hard. Provided, of course, the overcost is not huge. That extra expenditure buys you peace of mind. Regarding things like nurturing a community. That gave you this cool piece of software and hardware. And also, for example, the possible abuse of your credit card number. Okay, finally, with the list of perceived issues. Some people will say they don't have time to do it. Open source hardware designs, as free software, is often a showcase for a design group.
justamente design, assim, eu falo é livre, assim, como software livre, ele é um mostruário, ele demonstra o trabalho, revela o trabalho.
And they don't want to embarrass themselves by publishing suboptimal code or suboptimal designs.
Então eles não querem dar esse envergonhar, lançando um código que é abaixo da expectativa, enfim, um desenho, seja um projeto, seja abaixo da expectativa.
This should never be bad in principle, because it forces you to be good.
Isso não é a princípio, isso não é ruim, porque isso te força, te leva a precisar ser competente, precisar ser bom.
But it is true that in some contexts, you may not have time.
Mas é verdadeiro, também é verdadeiro, que em alguns contextos você talvez não tenha tempo.
So open source hardware is not for everyone all the time.
Então, o hardware aberto não é para todos a qualquer momento.
Moving on to recipes for success in open source hardware.
Agora, prosseguindo para receitas de sucesso no hardware aberto.
My experience is that most of it is common sense that has nothing to do with the fact that it's an open source hardware project.
Minha experiência me diz muito que trata-se de bom senso, que coisas que não têm necessariamente a ver com o fato de ser um projeto de hardware aberto.
So things like knowing what it is that you're supposed to be solving.
Coisas como saber o que você tem que resolver, saber do que se trata.
Prepare a plan, get a good team.
Preparar projeto, ter uma boa equipe.
Track progress, document, all common sense stuff.
Monitorar o progresso, coisas que são de bom senso.
In the category of things that are open source hardware specific,
de coisas que remetem à especificidade de hardware livre e aberto.
Enlarging your scope often helps.
Sorry?
Enlarging your scope, what it is you're trying to solve. So instead of solving your very particular problem, trying to solve a more general problem. So that other people can find your design useful.
Para que outras pessoas possam achar o seu projeto, seu design útil.
Then also, if you want to attract talent, being flexible is very important.
Também, se você quer atrair talento, ser flexível é muito importante.
Competent designers typically have a clear idea of how things should be done.
Quem é competente no design geralmente tem uma ideia clara a respeito do que deve ser feito.
And if you want to attract that kind of talent,
se você quer atrair esse tipo de talento,
you have to be flexible.
Você precisa ser flexível.
And the end product might not be what you had in mind to begin with.
E o resultado final pode não ser o que você tinha em mente ao começar.
And it might be for the better.
Então, seja melhor.
Another pattern we see quite often is partners.
Outro padrão que vemos com bastante frequência são
partners, walking a part of the path together, while their interests align. This is in the case of software, for example, very typical in the Linux kernel. You have companies contributing to the kernel. And then building a proprietary layer on top, which is what they monetize. Which is what they monetize. This is what they sell. They sell. So they have an interest that the Linux kernel, the basic infrastructure, is very good. Because that adds value to their proprietary offering as well. In the case of open source hardware, we have very similar cases. Like Google's contribution to the low-risk project. And the same could apply to free software tools for making hardware, for designing hardware.
Isso também se aplica às ferramentas que são utilizadas para criar o hardware.
Now, I would like to move on to say some words about public institutions.
Eu Então, eu gostaria agora de falar algumas palavras a respeito de instituições públicas.
Public institutions are special economic actors.
Instituições públicas são atores econômicos especiais.
While a private company represents the interests of a few people,
enquanto que uma empresa do setor privado representa os interesses de um grupo pequeno de pessoas,
which are the owners of the company,
que são os donos da empresa,
public institutions are supposed to represent the interests of a much larger set of people.
As instituições públicas estão ali para representar os interesses de um grupo maior de pessoas,
which form a society,
que forma uma sociedade,
and pay the taxes that help run these public institutions.
E pagam aí os impostos que ajudam essas instituições públicas a funcionarem.
Public institutions very often interact with private companies in the course of fulfilling their mission.
As empresas de setor privado muitas vezes contracenam, se relacionam com as empresas de setor público, onde vive a administração pública, para cumprirem com os seus propósitos, com suas metas.
And it is very important that they do so, maximizing their positive impact on society.
E é muito importante que façam isso para maximizar o seu papel na sociedade.
What might make sense in terms of cost and schedule from an engineering perspective,
o que pode fazer sentido em termos de custos, numa perspectiva de engenharia,
might not make so much sense from the perspective of a taxpayer. So it's not always easy to do things right when you work in a public institution. These institutions can also be tractor institutions. There are technologies and projects where an initial investment is needed. Which small companies cannot make, but a public institution might be able to make this investment.
Mas uma instituição pública pode ser capaz de fazer este investimento,
enabling private companies to continue afterwards,
capacitando daí as instituições a continuar depois.
And it's important for public institutions to be conscious of this important role they can play.
E é importante que as instituições públicas tenham consciência desse papel que elas podem vir a desempenhar.
Also, public institutions often have a procurement hat, so they buy stuff.
Então, as instituições públicas também têm, elas compram coisas.
And there as well, if we look at what happened in free software before,
e se olharmos o que acontecia antes com o software livre,
there are reasons to believe that they could start specifying open source hardware when they require development work. So they can when they require that somebody design something for them, they can specify that something be open source hardware. We have seen already many countries specify that software they buy must use file formats which are openly documented. Sometimes they will even specify that the software itself be free software, especially in the case where the software is developed for them. Then there is the funding agency's conundrum.
So,
some people will say this institution is funded by this region. Institution is funded by this region, or by this country, or by this set of countries. But now you're liberating the design to everybody.
Agora estados da Inglaterra que designam todos.
Not just the countries that helped fund that development.
Não só os países que ajudaram a fomentar esse desenvolvimento.
If you're really, really radical about non-sharing, I don't have a strong argument. If you're really radical about non-sharing,
not, se for realmente radical a respeito do não compartilhamento,
I don't have a strong argument.
Eu não tenho argumento forte.
But what we have experienced is that by collaborating with one or more companies from member states, they can still get quite a competitive advantage in an otherwise completely open source framework. And this is simply because not everything is in the design files. In a project, there are things which are very important, like design intent, ideas that didn't work, ideas about how to use this technology for other things in the future. All that is not in the design files, it's in the heads of the designers. So our experience is that through that method, companies can get quite a competitive advantage. Lastly, I want to mention a problem with public research. It's a problem of incentives. In research, very often we see something called co-petition. Co-petition, it's a mix of words.
Yeah,
cooperation and competition. Ideally, there's a bit of each. But in practice, there is often more competition than cooperation. Scientific research groups build infrastructure on their way to discoveries. This infrastructure has nothing to do with the scientific discoveries, it's just a tool. But often they will not share it with others out of fear. To be outcompeted on the scientific part, because they released and enabled their competitors by releasing these tools. Effectively, they are behaving as a private company would legitimately behave. But with public money. So from the perspective of a taxpayer, all this duplication of efforts is an unnecessary waste. But some of these research groups will tell you that their very survival might depend on this. So there's probably an incentives issue to be raised with the funding agencies. I would like to finish with some words about the future and the call for action. I think we need to do two things if we want to reach that dream of being like the software guys.
Alcançar esse sonho de ser os caras no hardware livre e aberto.
We need free software tools to design hardware.
Precisamos de ferramentas livres de software para criarmos o hardware.
And we need to get organized.
E precisamos nos organizar.
So, regarding tools,
então, em relação às ferramentas,
when you're a software developer,
quando você é desenvolvedor de software,
if you release a file and put it on the web,
se você libera um arquivo e coloca na rede,
you don't ask yourself if somebody is going to be able to open it.
Você não se pergunta se alguém vai saber abrir.
Or modify it.
Ou modificar.
Or compile it.
Ou compilar.
Or send you back a modification.
Ou devolver a você, voltar a você uma modificação.
The scene in open hardware, in hardware design, is dominated by proprietary design tools.
É dominado por ferramentas proprietárias.
With incompatible file formats.
Com formatos de arquivo incompatíveis.
And it's even worse than in the case of office suites.
E é pior do que os casos de office suites.
Because there is not a clear winner. There are four or five solutions.
Tem quatro ou cinco soluções.
With roughly equal shares of the market.
Que tem as mesmas fatias de mercado.
So if I release a file in a format of my proprietary tool,
se eu libero um arquivo com a minha ferramenta proprietária,
there are many chances that the recipient of that file does not hold a valid license for the same proprietary tool I used.
Não tem uma licença válida para fazer uso dessa mesma ferramenta proprietária que eu utilizei.
If we are going to have it as easy to share as the software guys,
se vamos facilitar o acesso e o compartilhamento assim como os caras do software,
we need high quality design tools.
Precisamos de ferramentas de design de alta qualidade,
which are free software. And this is an example. This is KiCad. It's a tool for designing PCBs, which is free software. And we have been contributing to it at CERN since 2011. We hope in the coming years it will become good enough in terms of features and quality.
Esperamos que nos próximos anos ficamos bons o suficiente em termos de características e de qualidade.
To start doing some of our work at CERN with it.
Para começarmos a fazer uso efetivo disso no CERN.
And we have a hackathon going on.
Temos um hackathon acontecendo aqui agora.
So if you're good in C++, I invite you.
Então eu convido vocês aí.
To join in the fun today, tomorrow, and Monday.
A se divertirem, né? Hoje acontece.
The other thing I think we need to do is to get organized. We have examples all around us that tell us that getting organized brings many benefits.
Estamos cercados de exemplos de que a organização traz muitos benefícios.
Look at the Free Software Foundation, look at Debian.
Olhar o Free Software Foundation, Debian.
I want to also mention the example of Scope 3, which has to do with the open access way of scientific of doing scientific publications that I mentioned earlier. So many institutes gathered all the scientific papers in the domain of high energy physics. And then they invited publishers to bid through a competitive tender. To offer prices, to quote prices for doing the publication, the editing and the publication. Using a standard CERN call for tender, so
using a standard
CERN call for tender, so You call for companies to quote prices. And the price for the taxpayers was dramatically decreased. So again, we see the benefits of getting organized. In the case of open source hardware, we have organizations already. We have the Open Source Hardware Association. FOSSI, the Free and Open Source Silicon Foundation. GOSH, the Gathering for Open Science Hardware, which deals with the specific case of hardware for science. And we need to deal with a number of issues. First of all, as I said, design files are not everything. To make sure that somebody can actually manufacture a design, there are ways of specifying that a given actor should play the game. So that people can reproduce that hardware. This can be done maybe through a certification program. Then there is the tools issue I described. Getting organized for that would also help. Then I didn't mention hardware description languages. Because of time, but it's also a very, very important issue. And in particular, in that domain, we need a good licensing regime. For weak and strong copyleft. For weak and strong copyleft. And there are already also a number of people working on quantifying the impact of open source hardware on society. And this should be very important to discuss with the funding agencies of public institutions. To conclude, we're designers, we like facts. We like facts. When we started 7 years ago at CERN, we had this open question. Will the companies play the game? As these web catalogs show, we're now buying open source hardware from companies. Some of which are the same companies that were selling proprietary hardware to us before. So I want to finish by thanking all of you for your attention. And thanking Julia for her patience with me and opening the mic for discussion. Thank you.